I love learning about the stories behind brands, but the ones that I particularly enjoy are those classic small fish taking on the big fish type of stories. These are the brands that took on a path that many never even considered simply because it just seemed too difficult. For Dollar Shave Club, this definitely was the case because as it was starting up, it was entering an industry that was dominated by Gillette and Schick, which controlled around 70% of the market, an almost monopoly-like level of a lead. But in only under 5 years, Dollar Shave Club would reduce that to 50% as it takes 20% of the offline razor market and at the same time, creating a 50% market share in the online razor market with over 4 million subscribers, shaking up the Goliaths Gillette and Schick. And that's why I wanted to learn more about the story behind the meteoric rise of Dollar Shave Club and its founder, Michael Dubin. As I read about Michael Dubin's story, I like the fact that you can point out how each of his experiences early on were able to contribute to his success in Dollar Shave Club. For one, his work ethic. Michael Dubin is a very hard worker, and he picked this up during his childhood. You see, he was brought up in an environment where work was encouraged. He shares how, before he was allowed to head out and play with his friends, he first had to get some homework done. So there was this sense of guilt if he wasn't able to do something productive before doing something for fun. Side note, Dubin shared that he wasn't a good student back then because he found it difficult to pay attention to subjects that didn't interest him, but he did okay. He was into a lot of extracurricular activities in college, even taking on internships at Bright House and CNN. After college, he worked as a page at NBC. Basically, a page is a 20-something-year-old working in various departments of the television network during a one-year period as a training ground for careers in television broadcasting and entertainment. NBC had this page program where they'd select 50 of these pages and they'd run around NBC studios. They'd be giving studio tours, seating the audience, and helping out in various departments. In exchange, these kids get to have opportunities to do different jobs across NBC's many departments. So they'd be exposed to what's actually happening behind these big shows, shows such as SNL, Nightly News, and many others. Dubin shared how this was his favorite job and that he really enjoyed this experience so much, which led him to discover a love for journalism and media. But later on, after this stint, he'd have a chance to work at a friend's cousin who ran a small marketing agency in New York City. After this, he'd move on to Life magazine and then to Sports Illustrated. During his time working in these companies, he finds himself starting to be super passionate about marketing and advertising. While he was at Life magazine and Sports Illustrated, he was tasked to build microsites for these brands. And these brands were quite big. He was building micro websites for Gatorade and Sega. And the amazing part was, he was just learning how to do this on the job. As he went along, he discovers how much he enjoyed working on the user experience. Learning about what made users do this or do that and how his work was able to lead in hundreds of thousands of visitors on these websites, it felt like his work was triggering people to follow his lead. And this was very satisfying. Going even further, building on his newfound love for marketing, he would later on work at a video marketing agency whose main focus was creating and distributing viral videos. Once again, another building block to Dollar Shave Club. But being the hard worker that he is, while he was doing his marketing job during the day, he made use of his free time at night doing improv. Dubin shares how he also had a love for comedy, and so he signed up for improv classes. Now, if you've seen the Dollar Shave Club video that went viral, at this point, you'd kinda see how all of these experiences have played their part in its success. But first, let's talk about how he came up with the idea. I love this part of the story because it is full of serendipitous moments, each essential to the fruition of the company. We begin in 2006 with the meeting of Michael Dubin and Mark Levine. Mark Levine is the dad of one of Dubin's friends. Levine was from South Africa who moved to the US. Back then, he was already a successful importer of products. Dubin shares how Levine would often just have a truck full of whatever products he's selling. One time, he had a truck full of soccer balls and another time, he had a truck full of bikes. They've been trying to get connected for a while now, but I guess the time wasn't right for that yet. But then eventually, the time came because Mark Levine finally felt the need of meeting Dubin, since he knew that Dubin was skilled in marketing and selling online. Since Levine was in the business of selling truckloads of various products, he figured they might make a good team. And so finally, Michael Dubin meets Mark Levine. Levine tells Dubin that he had a warehouse full of products he needed to sell and asked him if he can go help him out. Levine tells him that he has around 250,000 razors that's in the warehouse. It was around this time when Dubin started to think about his experience when buying razors. He recalls that when he was in New York City, he remembers dreading buying razors because of the process of it all. You see, you couldn't just drop by a store, grab it from a shelf, and leave with the razors. No. Razors were always locked in a glass cabinet shelf, and he always needed to find the person who had the key. And that person usually had a grumpy look, making you feel like you inconvenienced him or her. It wasn't a pleasant experience, and he needed to go through this regularly when he needed razors because razors are one of the few products that required you to go through this experience. Dubin shares that it was at this point when he thought of Dollar Shave Club. Dubin then checks out the quality of the razors in the warehouse, brings a couple of them home, shaves using these razors, and comes to the conclusion that, yes, these are the type of razors that he could use on a regular basis. Dubin then calls Levine, tells him, alright, I'm in. He shares with Levine that he wants to sell these razors online. That this could work well with a subscription business model where people no longer needed to buy from their local store, nor will they need to order them manually online. You set it and forget it, and your razors will arrive regularly. This is honestly a great idea, but it doesn't keep you from thinking about what the thought process was behind his decision to drop everything and pursue building this company. And I personally love Dubin's response to this. He talks about how, normally, entrepreneurs trust their gut, and he trusts his gut. And his gut told him that his problem of not wanting to go to the store to buy overpriced razors, he believed that if he had this problem, that if he felt this way, that many other men in the same situation were experiencing the same frustration. He just felt that there was a problem here that needs a solution and that this can be what solves it. He certainly didn't think that it would be as big as it has become, but Dubin believed that there truly was a problem worth solving here. And so he went for it and started getting to work. First, the brand name. It was an easy process, really. Dubin just wanted a name that, if you were to mention it to someone on the street, he would be able to figure out what the business is doing. And so, Dollar Shave Club was born. In 2011, Dubin puts in money from his savings and a small investment from his partner, Mark Levine. This initial investment allowed them to hire a couple of developers to build their beta site. They were just testing out different pricing models, seeing what customers responded to best. In the beginning, they were reaching people through Google Ads, Groupon, and SEO. But of course, this needed a bit of offline help, as Dubin shares how he would hustle it out in the streets, joining whatever events and conferences would get his brand the much-needed awareness. And you know how you always remember your first sale? Well, Dubin vividly recalls how great it felt when they had their first sale. He recalls the name and what he was doing at that time when they had their first customer, who isn't part of the family or their group of friends. Just a stranger customer who found the brand online. And he was ecstatic because it was validation. It was a sign that, yes, somebody gets it. Gradually, Dollar Shave Club was getting some sales here and there, but definitely not at the level that would make them threaten the giants Gillette and Schick. You see, the razor market is considered by many as a near impenetrable market. The grasp that Gillette and Schick have is very solid, unsurprisingly because these two have been around for decades. Schick has been around since 1926 and was acquired by Energizer Holdings from Pfizer. Energizer is the battery brand you're very much familiar with. And Gillette is owned by Procter & Gamble and has been around since 1901. Just to put into perspective the size of Gillette, in 2005, Gillette was acquired by Procter & Gamble, or P&G, for $57 billion. When a company is willing to pay $57 billion for your brand, it's quite a big vote of confidence that things will continue to work out well long into the future. And so, Michael Dubin knew that in order to gain some ground against these heavily entrenched giants, he not only needed to beat them by selling a better product, but by selling a better story. And what better way to tell a story than through video? This is where the viral video comes in. For the few of you who haven't seen the video yet, just type in Dollar Shave Club on YouTube. You won't miss it since it's the top result. This video launched the company into the cult brand it is today. Best part is, it didn't even cost much to make it. The production cost around $4,500, which is relatively inexpensive compared to the budget that other brands have. I've been building this up since the start of this episode, describing how Dubin's past experiences contributed to the success of the brand. His past work at a video marketing agency, being in the media industry, and taking improv classes, you can see all of these blossom in the video. Because of his background in marketing and improv, Dubin was equipped. He knew how to write, he knew how to perform, and he's really funny. Dubin sought the help of a friend of his who directed one of the shows he was in, and asked her to review the script. She added a couple more jokes to it, and she was actually the one who adds in the part where he says, "Our blades are fucking great." One more factor that contributed to the impact of the video was the timing. Dubin wanted the ad to run on March 6, which was when news would be out about a successful round of funding for the company. He knew that news outlets would link their articles to the video as they talked about this funding round. Also, more importantly, this was just right before South by Southwest. Normally, there is a lull before this event and people are usually on the lookout for something new. He figured that this would be a perfect time to launch the video so that people would be talking about it during the event. And so, as they released their video, they did their usual round of press, TechCrunch, Bloomberg, and the rest of the media outlets. They were expecting the brand's story to reach a lot of people, but not at the intensity of the response they received. Because people absolutely loved it. The thing is, the video felt like a comedy skit, but it delivered a message. And as soon as people realized that this wasn't just a comedy skit and that there was an actual business behind this funny ad, people took action. The tech community in particular picked it up first, and as Dubin describes it perfectly, it caught wildfire. Dubin shares that when he woke up the following morning, his phone was buzzing with messages from friends saying that the video is great but that they couldn't order the razors from their site. He checks the website himself and couldn't see it. Apparently, the site has crashed and he finds out that they've not only sold all 250,000 razors, but that they didn't have enough products to send to the remaining orders of customers. He realizes that he has to order another set of razors and the customers will have to wait. Eventually, he just tells customers that they'll send the razors in a couple of months. Normally, this would be a big turnoff for customers, but since the value proposition resonated with the brand's new audience, they waited and hung around. A big reason why is because of how the video shared Dollar Shave Club's simple story, which is that razors are overpriced. People are paying too much for technology they don't need. You can get a good shave without paying too steep of a price, and that you no longer have to think about buying razors because they'll be delivered to you regularly. And as Dubin's gut feel predicted, many others felt the same way. The viral video's impact was huge. Posted for free on YouTube, within 24 hours, the brand had more than 12,000 orders. As of the making of this episode, the video has over 26 million views, amounting to over $6 million in sales within 2012, the year that it launched the viral video. A common denominator as to how direct-to-consumer brands are slowly dethroning giants in their industries is a prime focus on the customer experience. When buying from Dollar Shave Club, your package comes in a beautifully branded box, a playful welcome note, the products that you ordered, an explanation of occasional free samples, and a copy of the Bathroom Minutes, a monthly newsletter from Dollar Shave Club that includes a note from the chairman, member spotlight, quotes, and club news, among other things. Being a member of Dollar Shave Club makes you feel like you're in on the joke and that you're part of an exclusive community that you can't get from any other brand. Other brands can copy the subscription mechanism of Dollar Shave Club, but one thing that is quite difficult to duplicate is the community that the brand has built, mainly because it relies heavily on authenticity. And speaking of copying, Gillette has actually launched its own shave club, namely the Gillette Shave Club. But that's the thing, it just doesn't feel right. It feels a bit pretentious. Dollar Shave Club has owned a tone of voice that Gillette will find hard to mimic. And it's working out well for them. Dubin shares that over 50,000 Dollar Shave Club customers refer a friend every single month. Part of the brand's advertising budget is allocated in making the customer experience extraordinary because they understand that by doing so, people will do the advertising for them. The foundation of an extraordinary customer experience is the solving of a consumer pain point. I mean, you can send your product in gold packaging and add a ton of freebies, but if it doesn't solve the problem, it is not going to last. Dollar Shave Club's solution was simple. Instead of paying $10 to $20 a month for razors, by physically heading to a store without leaving your home, you can set up your regular order of razors online. All in a set and forget system. Meaning, you set them up once, set how often you'll need the razors, and it'll be delivered to you regularly at a price that starts at $1 to $5 depending on the type of razors that you ordered. This is ridiculously inexpensive, and the thing is, Dollar Shave Club doesn't actually make money off of their $1 package. They've since moved on from this price point, but in the beginning, customers were able to get a two-blade razor for $1. And this entry-level offer was more of a hook to draw customers in, because as customers got over their doubts on Dollar Shave Club's model, the brand sold them their 4-blade and 6-blade razors. Both were at progressively higher price points and margins. Today, Dollar Shave Club starts you off with a $5 starter kit that comes with a razor handle, a pack of blades, and their shave butter. Best part is, the brand has since expanded into other product lines. They now have products for oral care, a toothbrush, dental floss, toothpaste, products for hair styling, deodorants, wipes, shampoo, soap, among other things. They've pretty much paid a lot of attention to what men look for in personal grooming. And to a great extent, Dubin has always given customer feedback a high priority. During the early days of the brand, his small team would travel the country and go to events where you normally wouldn't really talk about grooming. Events such as the Maine Lobster Festival and the Gilroy Garlic Festival. Their goal was to meet average guys and learn about what they wanted. Dubin discovered that men actually wanted to talk about personal grooming, but that they weren't too adventurous about it. When it's about this subject, men just want the basics, but the type of basics that were actually great. He also discovered that men weren't too knowledgeable about personal grooming, and so one of Dollar Shave Club's goals was to lead the conversation as an educator that men actually want to hear from. And to lead a conversation, you first needed to listen. Dollar Shave Club's products are a result of a lot of listening. One of the brand's product developers, Fadi Murad, shares how normally, brands look at trends and attempt to forecast what their customers would want. But in Dollar Shave Club, a different approach worked better. They would hold a lot of small consumer panels and just ask the panel about their whole routine in the bathroom. With this, they uncovered pain points. Murad shares how in one panel, they were discussing rough toilet paper, and this is how they came up with a One Wipe Charlie's, a flushable wet wipe. He says that no trend could have hinted that men wanted butt wipes. Sure enough, the brand has had products that failed. Their exfoliating cloth in particular gained a lot of bad reviews, but instead of hiding their reaction, they listened to their customers, talked to them about it, and they redesigned the product in less than 2 weeks. They also sent out a refund to all 64,000 members who purchased it, even if the members didn't ask for a refund. Amazing. The brand has since launched a 500-person panel that allows the brand to test out products before they're launched. It's an invite-only group of the brand's long-standing customers, greatly reducing the risk of launching a product that its community doesn't want. At least 80% of their tested products eventually make it to market. Despite Dollar Shave Club's meteoric rise, we can't discount the fact that P&G's Gillette is still a formidable competitor. As I mentioned earlier, Gillette launched their own home delivery subscription service, the Gillette Shave Club. But in order to not disrupt themselves, they maintained their margins, making them still a lot more expensive than Dollar Shave Club. Despite this, Michael Dubin never considered selling the company. He shares that this was a detour from his initial roadmap. When Dubin was in talks with banks for the brand's Series D funding, he met Romitha Mali, JB Morgan's then managing director. She then ran into Keith Krethoff, president of Unilever's North American operations. Mali tells Krethoff about the brand they just raised money for, a rising men's grooming brand with sticky customers. Krethoff was intrigued and asked to meet with Dubin. The three had dinner, and there was an instant chemistry between them. This is when Dubin first thinks about possibilities. Imagine a disruptive innovator in Dollar Shave Club with the resources of a multinational conglomerate in Unilever. Unilever was not a significant player in the razor market. Unilever saw Dollar Shave Club as an entry point, a spearhead into the coveted market which was dominated by its rival, P&G. Funny thing is, Dubin thought that he could get Krethoff to be an advisor in Dollar Shave Club's board, but Unilever had other plans. After seeing the brand's Super Bowl commercial, it proposed to fully acquire Dollar Shave Club. The offer was irresistible. Unilever promised Dubin all the flexibility and freedom to do what he felt was required for the brand to succeed. Basically, do what you're doing now, pursue the path you were gonna take, but let's expedite that journey because now you have access to Unilever's distribution network and its war chest of capital. Dubin would no longer have to spend time running around raising funding. With Unilever's money, he gets to spend all his time and energy building Dollar Shave Club at a rate he couldn't have ever imagined before. So on July 19, 2016, while he was in his hotel room in his pajamas, he opens his laptop, opens DocuSign, and a $1 billion contract is right in front of him. He clicks OK, and the sale is finalized. He shares that he took a screenshot because it was so unceremonious. Far from it though, because in only 4 years after its launch, Dollar Shave Club is officially acquired by Unilever for $1 billion in cash. With this move, Unilever now has a 16% share of the market and is now second right behind Gillette. Today, Dubin is feeling relaxed. He's still doing what he's been doing ever since he launched Dollar Shave Club without worrying about running out of money. Dollar Shave Club now operates in Canada, Australia, and the UK. Each country the brand expands to requires further listening to the local audience to understand what they actually need, since grooming standards for each nationality may vary. Sounds like a tough task to overcome, but knowing what Dollar Shave Club has done in the past under Michael Dubin's leadership, if they can make something as mundane as buying razors something you look forward to, I'm sure they can figure this one out as well. And so that's about it. Now you know about the brand origin story of Dollar Shave Club. My name is Chris, and I'll be back again next time for another episode of Brand Origins. If you enjoyed the show, it would mean a lot if you could tell your friends about Brand Origins. You can also talk to us on Twitter. We're at BrandOriginsFM. If you prefer the audio version of this, you can search for Brand Origins on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, or on your favorite podcast app.